The following message was given at Grace Community Church in Minden, Nevada.
Tonight, we're going to depart from 1 Corinthians just for a bit, and we're going to talk about this issue of the Christian and his country. And of course, historically, there are a number of reasons why we should talk about this. Biblically, there are a number of reasons why we should talk about this. Over the last week or so, I've spent time reading in R.L. Dabney, who was a Southern Presbyterian, writing on basically Christian patriotism in 1860. So put that in historical context. Also, John L. Dagg, who was a Baptist theologian, on practical ethics and the responsibility of Christians to their country, wrote that treatise in 1859. And so both of those written in the midst of some incredibly tumultuous times. And so anyway, it got me thinking that maybe it would be helpful if we talked about some of these things. So I'd like you to take your Bibles and turn to, first of all, Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. And hopefully I'll finish in time so that we can take some questions. In Philippians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul says this. He says, verse 20, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of his glory by the exertion of the power that he has even to subject all things to himself." And so was Paul a Roman citizen? Yes. Did he actually appreciate being a Roman citizen? Absolutely, especially when it spared him a flogging, right? And yet he says here, our citizenship, the commonwealth to which we belong, is in heaven. In 1 Peter chapter 2, we read, the whole book of 1 Peter has this emphasis. And Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, "Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts which wage war against the soul." And throughout the book of 1 Peter, Peter will refer to believers as exiles, aliens, and strangers. And so we're exiles in this world. We are strangers and aliens, which means we're, in a sense, immigrants who don't ultimately belong here. And so when we talk about the Christian and his country, the very first thing that we need to assert without any ambiguity is that we're citizens of God's kingdom above all else, all right? As Christians, that should be something that is crystal clear to us. We are citizens of God's kingdom above all else. Now, I want to just draw out three things in terms of what that means. So first, our primary citizenship is in heaven. It's in the kingdom of God. We've been transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of God's beloved Son, Colossians 1:13. And our primary citizenship in heaven takes precedence over our earthly citizenship. It also takes precedence over all earthly loyalties. Our citizenship in heaven, think of it this way, our citizenship in heaven relativizes all other loyalties. That is, all other loyalties are put into subjection to our loyalty to Jesus Christ. And so for the Christian, whatever country he may live in, citizenship in heaven doesn't erase our earthly citizenship or erase earthly loyalties, but it nullifies all other loyalties as absolute. And so, this is why, and every once in a while, somebody will ask me, why don't you have the American flag up on the platform with the Christian flag? Okay. Just out of curiosity, how many of you grew up in churches where you had an American flag on one side and the Christian flag, whatever the Christian flag is, on the other? Okay. So some of you grew up in that tradition. You can be as patriotic as you can be, but I want to tell you that the very symbolism of having the flag of your country up alongside a Christian flag communicates the wrong message. There are not two equal loyalties. We have one supreme loyalty, and that is to our King and to his kingdom. And so there are no loyalties apart from our loyalty to Jesus Christ, which are absolute. Okay? In other words, loyalty to him relativizes all other loyalties. The second thing is that as Christians of the kingdom of heaven, we have a distinct Christian worldview. So just as Paul was a Roman citizen, so we are American citizens, all right? But we view our citizenship through a Christian worldview. So I am an American citizen, but because I am preeminently a citizen of the kingdom of heaven, I view my citizenship as an American through the lens of a biblical worldview. So there's no division or bifurcation between my citizenship in the kingdom of God and my citizenship in the United States. In other words, I don't have a view that says, since I'm a citizen of this kingdom over here, I operate with these ethics when I'm over here. And because I'm a citizen of the country here, I operate with these ethics here. We don't make that distinction. I view my citizenship in the United States of America through the lens of God's word, right? So R.L. Dabney says, every Christian man, whether lawmaker or law executor or voter, should carry his Christian conscience, enlightened by God's word, into his political duty. Here then is a prominent duty. If we would save our country, and remember he's writing in 1860, if we would save our country, that we shall carry our citizenship in the kingdom of heaven everywhere and make it dominate over every public act. Okay? In other words, you go into the voting booth, you go as a Christian. All right? Third, this also means that our ultimate hope is never in our earthly country, but always in our heavenly one. Even Abraham, Hebrews chapter 11, verses 13 to 16, even Abraham actually saw the promised land that God had given him not as his ultimate home. He was looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. Right. And if he was looking, so the writer of the Hebrews says, if he was looking for that country, he could have gone back. But instead, he was looking for a country that is a heavenly one. All right. So as wonderful as the United States are, the United States is not our ultimate hope. It's not our ultimate home. It's not our ultimate country. It is the heavenly country, which is the ultimate. All right. So, we have the conviction, the foundational perspective that our citizenship is in God's kingdom, and that is preeminent above everything else, all right? But number two, our attitude towards the country where God has placed us. So if we're, you understand, if we're citizens of the kingdom of heaven first and foremost, what does that mean in terms of how we view citizenship in this earthly country, right? You have to actually reckon with that, okay? We are not, talk about this more in a second, I suppose, but we're not pietists who just think that this life doesn't matter at all. All that matters is heaven. Okay? Nor are we fundamentalists in the sense that we don't care about the culture, the society, or the world because, after all, it's just polishing brass on the Titanic. Right? So what is our perspective of this present country where God has placed us? Well, I'd like you to look at two passages. The first is in Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17. Paul is on Mars Hill, and he's giving his sermon at the Areopagus. And I'm going to back up to verse 24 so that we get the whole sentence here. Acts 17:24, "The Lord who made the world and all things in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation." So you know what this means, by the way. It means, first of all, that God is sovereign over the boundaries of nations. That's really good to know. But he's not only sovereign over the boundaries of nations, he's also sovereign over the habitation of those nations. Did any of you, while you were still just simply in the mind of God, not even in your mother's womb, put in a request where you would be born? I mean, Vic, did you say Canada? No. Dominican Republic? No. None of us got to choose the place of our birth, did we? Absolutely sovereign. And I can tell you that, having been in many other places in this world, I am profoundly grateful to the sovereign God of heaven that I was born in the country in which I was born. God has determined those boundaries. God has determined that habitation. And so the country that you are in, whether you are born there or whether you migrate there, the fact is that you are there by the sovereign decree of Almighty God. Kids have very little appreciation for the blessing of being born in this great nation. The other thing is, Jeremiah chapter 29. Now, Jeremiah chapter 29 is a part of what's called the Book of Consolation. And the Book of Consolation is actually written to a group of Jews, but Jews that actually have already been exiled. Okay? So they have been taken from their homeland, Israel, and they are now exiles in Babylon. Okay? And this is what God says to the exiles, Jeremiah 29:4. "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, and plant gardens and eat their produce. take wives and become the fathers of sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands that they may bear sons and daughters and multiply there and do not decrease. Seek the welfare, seek the shalom of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its shalom, you will have shalom. Okay. Now, what's interesting about this is that these are Israelites. These are citizens of Judah who have been exiled. So they have a natural affinity towards their homeland. They have been removed by the decree of God, all right, the sovereign purpose of God, and they're now in a country that is not their home country. But what does God say to them? He says, build your houses, have your families, and labor for the good of the city, the peace, the shalom of the city, which I have sent you. Now, if you were, let's say you were a super zealous, patriotic, a Jewish person at that time, you might say, why would I do that for Babylon? Well, here we are as exiles. Strangers and aliens. We are waiting to finally return to our homeland, our heavenly country. And as exiles, we should labor for the good of the city that God has placed us. We should labor for the shalom of the city that God has placed us, because in its shalom, we have shalom, right? So what do I make of Acts 17 and Jeremiah 29? And it's this, and that is to have affection for your earthly homeland, to have an affection for the place of your birth, to have affection for the country or the state that you live in is a natural affection. To be patriotic and to love your birthplace or your fatherland is to recognize God has put me here. God by his grace made me a citizen of this great nation, and I am to labor for its good. Okay? Again, I repeat that we are not pietists who somehow deny the goodness of this present life. We don't have a worldview that says this world is just junk and our only hope is heaven. That's not the way that we should view the world. We should have a biblical view of this world and the world to come that says this, that although the world to come is exponentially greater than this present world is still a blessing, although filled with woe and misery. And this present world is worthy of our care to the very nation and place where we belong. We should labor for God's glory and for our neighbor's good, and for our children, and for our children's children. If there is anything about this, these current crises that are going on that rips my heart out, it is that this is the world that my grandchildren are going to grow up in. And for love of neighbor and love of my family, I should have a priority that says I seek the good of the city in which I live, first spiritually and then earthly. And so I would say that it's right and it's good to love the nation in which you live, to love the country in which you live, to see it as a blessing from Almighty God. So that brings us to number three. What should love for country look like? Okay. And let me just there are going to be things here that we need to spend more time on, but we're not going to have all the time to spend. So what does love for country look like? Okay. First of all, I would say that love for country is having an acute sense of gratitude for the blessings that God has given through that country. Okay. So in order to actually have a sense of gratitude for the blessings of the nation in which we live, okay, we should know about God's dealings with our nation in its history. Okay. Anybody ever hear of Cotton Mather? One, two, three, four. Okay, you probably knew him. All right, Cotton Mather, okay? John Cotton, early Boston preacher, famous preacher, was the father to Increase Mather, who then was the father of Cotton Mather. And Cotton Mather was a contemporary of Jonathan Edwards, and he wrote this massive two-volume work called The Great Works of Christ in America. And do you know what it was designed to do? It was designed to just simply catalog the providential dealings of God with those who actually were fleeing religious persecution and coming to this country for religious freedom and for peace and prosperity. Okay. The Great Works of Christ in America is like Dawn's Prayer earlier, right? We're just recounting, Lord, there's fire on both sides of the road, and you got us through the smoke. And even though the fire was coming, you caused the winds to come and it stopped the fire. It's just recounting the wonderful ways in which God blessed this nation and its founding. Knowing things like that, absolutely crucial. Also, an expression of gratitude for the blessings. Know the founders. Know the founding documents. Know that Christopher Columbus was not some sort of genocidal maniac. Know that George Washington and Thomas Jefferson are actually heroes, not villains. Okay. Understand the men. Now, I'm not saying for a single solitary second that all of our founding fathers were evangelical Christians. That's historical mythology. Okay. But there was a common Christian worldview, and many of these men were men of stalwart faith. Know who they are. Right? Know the founding documents. Understand why we have a constitution, why we have a Bill of Rights, why we have a preamble to that constitution. Know the history of the church in our country. Do you actually know why, for instance, the very idea of separation of church and state is a staple idea built in, not found explicitly in the Constitution, but found explicitly in the early writings? It was actually a statement of liberty, religious liberty. By the way, do you know who the strongest advocates were for religious liberty in the early 1700s and into the time of the Revolutionary War and into the early 1800s? The strongest proponents of religious liberty were Baptists. Did you know that? Do you know the name Roger Williams? Know the history of the church in our nation. Understand why we are different than, let's say, Lutheran sections of Germany or Lutheran sections of Sweden or the Netherlands that had state churches. Understand why our founders refused to have the state actually establish a formal church and why Congress was not permitted to do that. Understand that it's the very foundation of the religious liberties upon which we stand. Be thankful for the blessings of our liberty and the prosperity that we've experienced as a nation. They're not going to last much longer. Be thankful. Be thankful for the liberty and the freedom that we have in this nation. Thanks be to God we're not like China. Thanks be to God that we're not like many African nations or Russia. We have freedoms. And here's the thing, as you see all of these foolish people today who think that those who have lived through the horrific bondage of socialism and communism somehow are way better off than a free people. Here's another way to express your gratitude. Teach your children history. Okay. By the way, and I say this with my dear wife who is present, public school will not teach an accurate view of history. Okay? Okay. When the next generation grows up and they don't know a thing about the greatest generation, and they don't know a thing about Normandy, and they don't know a thing about the Alamo, and they don't know a thing about the Battle of New Orleans, and they don't know a thing about Andrew Jackson, is it any wonder that they indiscriminately tear down statues of even those who were opposed to slavery? Teach your children history. Teach them American history. Teach it accurately. Realize that when there's no knowledge of history and no sense of gratitude for our nation and its founding, and there then grows the desire to expunge anyone or anything from our nation that seems offensive. That, by the way, sets the stage for anarchy. There never was an anarchist who had a deep appreciation of history. Anarchy grows from wanting to erase history. Gratitude for the blessings of this nation. Second, what should love for country look like? Mourning the sins of our nation. My eyes weep streams of water, says the psalmist, because they do not keep your law. Our hearts should mourn our national sins. As people who love and appreciate the country which God blessed us to live in, we should mourn the sin of abortion. We should despise it. We should recognize in abortion not only are the very principles of life that are rooted in the Word of God defied, but the very principles upon which this nation are built are defied every time an unborn life is taken. It is an absolute contradiction to everything that we stand for biblically and as Americans. It is wicked. This is why, by the way, you dare not separate the idea of being a citizen in this country and a citizen in the kingdom of heaven. Being a citizen in the kingdom of heaven actually means that we look at our nation through the lens of the Word of God. We should mourn our Supreme Court. And we should mourn the gross disappointment of our Supreme Court justice. We should mourn the decisions that have recently been made. Remember, those decisions are going to have implications for your children and your grandchildren. Mourn the sins of the nation. If you have a love for your country, you can't help but to mourn the sins of the nation. Third, what is gratitude, or what does love for country look like? Well, it looks like submission to authority. Romans chapter 13 is actually unambiguous that we are to submit to the governing authorities. And so we are to obey laws and we are to pay our taxes. We're to be good citizens. We talked not all that long ago when we talked about Christ Caesar and the obedience of the church on the role of civil disobedience. But let's just remember something. Civil disobedience is the exception. It's not the rule. Christians are not rebels. Christians are not anarchists. Christians don't just flaunt the law because they don't agree with it. I just don't go out and just shoot two deer even though I have a deer tag, because I don't think it's fair. Or I don't drive down the road at 89 miles an hour. Well, if I do, I hope I get a ticket. And if I keep it within that 10 mile, you know, anyway. So yeah, speeding is not probably a good example for me. But anyway, we obey the laws. And so Christians are to submit to the laws. But to love your country also means that you're a citizen with moral conviction. You're not just blindly obedient to everything that is said to you. So our moral convictions, as Christians, where do our moral convictions come from? Our moral convictions come from our biblical worldview. So I have some passages there listed in the notes, and let me just recount these to you. So here's Daniel. Daniel actually tells the king, Nebuchadnezzar, to break off from your sins and to pursue righteousness. Okay. Boldness, right? Where does Daniel get off telling the king to do that? He had a higher authority. His moral convictions came from the fact that he had a higher authority. Mark chapter 6, verses 17 to 20. Here you have John the Baptist. And of course, when you think of John the Baptist, you know what you think of. You think of the forerunner of Jesus, the Messiah, who is preaching what? Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight paths, right? And the Lord is coming. But here's what else John the Baptist did. He told Herod that it was unlawful for him to have his brother's wife. He called Herod out on his immorality. Think about the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 24. You know what he talked to Felix about? He talked to Felix about judgment, the judgment to come. And so as Christians, if we're going to be Christians who have a biblical worldview, that's going to lead to moral convictions that are grounded. So as Christians, we don't just simply say, well, we need to abdicate our convictions as citizens of the United States because those aren't shared convictions. Rather, we in turn stand all the more determined. Does our culture agree in the main with our view of life? Certainly over the last number of years, opinions about abortion have shifted and become more pro-life. But guess what? There are still lots and lots of people who believe that it is a woman's right to terminate a pregnancy at any time. And now a lot of people will say, well, I think it's only the first trimester or the first two trimesters. But the fact is that our view of life is rooted and grounded in biblical conviction about the reality that God is the author of life. And that life begins at conception. And so, as a Christian, I dare not abdicate my view of life and my view, my opposition to abortion, simply because it's not popular. Rather, I need to stand all the firmer because I'm standing not simply on the latest polls about how the society feels about these things. I'm standing on the unalterable Word of God. What about marriage? Biblical conviction is what forms our moral convictions. And let me just remind us how quickly these things change. Can anybody think back to 2008? It really was not that long ago, okay? We had Barack Obama and Joe Biden running for president and vice president. Do you know what both of them were opposed to? Gay marriage. You do realize that. Both were at least publicly opposed to gay marriage. So look where we are right now, a mere 12 years later. Not only did the Supreme Court put its imprimatur on gay marriage, okay, but now if you don't believe in gay marriage, you're a bigot. You can't tell me who to love. You know the rhetoric, okay? As a Christian, I have absolutely, if I'm going to believe the Bible, I have absolutely no choice but to stand on the creational ordinance that marriage is between a man and a woman and only between a man and a woman. If I'm going to believe the Bible, then I have to stand on the conviction that there are only two genders. If I'm going to stand on the Bible, then I have to actually have the conviction in my heart of hearts that homosexuality, bisexuality, transgenderism are actually violations of the creation ordinance that God has made when he made man male and female. Okay? Does that put me out of the mainstream of thought? And the answer is, of course it does. But I will just tell you, the mainstream of thought is an ever-moving current. I feel sorry for Christians that actually just get swept along with whatever the current is. Stand on the bedrock of God's word. It doesn't change. Okay? Does the Bible actually give us, let's say, principles on economics and how to deal with the poor? Yep. Okay. Does the Bible give us wisdom on things like work and personal responsibility? Okay. In other words, there's actually a biblical worldview on economics. There are biblical principles that should inform how we deal with poverty. Okay? The Bible actually gives us these things and unfolds them for us. And moral conviction. Now, by the way, let me just say that your conviction about economics should not actually be on the same level as your conviction about life and marriage. Okay? Moral conviction actually compels us to resist evil and to work for justice. Okay? And by the way, justice is a biblical category. Next way to love your country: be a citizen of moral influence. Okay? Don't just be a person of moral conviction, but be a person of moral influence. Okay? salt and light. Salt is that preservative. Light is that which illumines. Being, as Paul puts it, shining stars in a crooked and perverse generation. And so here's where a lot of Christians struggle, because we are to exercise an influence in the world in which we live. All right? I don't want to embarrass anybody, but we have someone here who labors tirelessly for life choices and for the sake of the unborn. Okay. Do you not think that the presence of life choices in Carson City is a moral influence for good? Absolutely. What about City of Refuge? A moral influence for good. Okay. And so we are to be people who don't live in such a way that I say, well, I've got my Christian life and then I've got my civic life. As a Christian, there's no distinction. My Christianity is what shapes my civic life. It's what shapes my convictions. It's what shapes me to want to be an influence in this world, an influence for our nation. Next, engage in its service. So what does this look like? Well, let me just say that there's all kinds of ways to serve our nation. There are obvious ways, military. To serve as a Christian in the military is a noble thing. Okay. Do we have anybody in the Bible that was in the military? Okay. Well, I mean, King David to me is like he's the paramount example, right? And so many of you will remember Major Mark Hand. Major Mark Hand served the United States Marine Corps for over 20 years, deployed multiple times, served his country with integrity and with Christian conviction. Right? It is a noble thing to serve your country in the military. But there's also political service. Political service is actually a valid means of serving your country. Do we have any, we'll just say, Christian politicians in the Bible? Scratching your head. By the way, when I say politician, don't necessarily think Harry Reid, because then you'll be looking hard and never find one. Daniel actually was a high up official in the Babylonian government. What about Joseph? Joseph actually served Egypt in the highest office next to Pharaoh and did it with distinction and honor to the glory of God. Okay. Now, I know that it's hard to believe that there could be political service for the glory of God. That's because our distrust of politicians is so immense. I know a man, however, in the state of Oregon, who is an outstanding, he's not just a Christian, he's actually a Reformed Baptist, and he served his state Congress for two terms and did it as a Christian and did it with honor and integrity. Chris Barreto. Okay. It can be done, and it should be done. It's hard to whine and cry about the levels of corruption in our politics when Christians actually refuse to engage. Police officers, firemen, law enforcement, teachers. I'm no fan of the public schools, but I will tell you, there are many Christians who have devoted their lives to service in the public schools and have done inestimable good to individual students and have made marks upon their lives. John Dagg, who was a Baptist theologian, he says, in order to the stability and success of their government, citizens are bound as far as they can to render it virtuous and efficient. The best form of government must be unsuccessful if the administration of it be committed to weak and dishonest hands. Should I read that again to you? In order to the stability and success of their government, citizens are bound as far as they can to render it virtuous and efficient. The best form of government must be unsuccessful if the administration of it be committed to weak or dishonest hands. Okay. I think that we know that one by experience. Finally, pray for your country. Pray for your country. As you pray for your country, do you have biblical warrant to pray for your country? Absolutely. So 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, we're to pray for kings and rulers and those in authority, right? And Paul says we're supposed to do that so that we in turn can lead a peaceful and tranquil life. Okay. So we should be praying. So that, by the way, that's the principle of Jeremiah 29. In the city Shalom, you'll have Shalom. And so we pray for those who are in authority over us. We pray for our elected officials. By the way, as Christians, that means that we pray for the presidents that we like and we pray for the presidents that we don't like. Pray for your country. Pray for your elected officials. Pray for the president. Pray for our senators. Pray for those in Congress. Pray for those that are at the state level, that are legislators. Pray for local officials. Pray for your county commissioners. Pray for the people that God has, in his providence, Romans 13, 1, put in positions of authority. Pray for them. As we pray for our nation, we should also pray prayers of confession and repentance. There are national sins that we as the people of God should confess. Ezra 9, Nehemiah 9, Daniel 9 are all prayers for the nations in which those three men resided. And those prayers are prayers of national confession and repentance. We should be confessing the sins of our nation, and we should be, insofar as it depends on us, repenting. Again, R.L. Dabney says, the guilty churches of our land should humble themselves before a holy God for their Christian backsliding and for our national sins. This next one is going to be a little, probably strike you as a little strange. Pray imprecations against evil. Okay. You know what the imprecatory psalms are? Those are the psalms that C.S. Lewis said seemed sub-Christian. C.S. Lewis certainly didn't get everything right. Imprecatory psalms are those psalms that call down judgment on God's enemies. And there are numerous imprecatory psalms, okay? The church, by and large, has ignored the imprecatory psalms as somehow less than Christian, maybe a little embarrassed to read them publicly, let alone sing them. We actually sing a section of an imprecatory psalm when we sing number 71, Stand Up, O God, Be Present Now, which is from Psalm 68. And the imprecation from Psalm 68 that is in that him is rebuke the godless, cast them down till humbled they for mercy call. Okay. I want us to understand something. It is righteous to pray against evil. Okay. It is righteous to pray against evil. And we have to understand that there are people in places of power in our country that actually favor killing children even up to birth. Okay. That's evil. Okay. That's evil. There is so much evil at high levels of authority that that evil is an affront to a holy God, and to pray that God removes people from office. And so let me just tell you the way that I pray imprecatory prayers. I say, Lord, save that person. But if you do not save them, remove them from their position of power. Okay? Would we be better off as a nation if the wicked were removed from positions of power? The next way we pray for our country is to pray for revival and awakening and missions, right? Remember, Paul's heart was for his kinsmen, according to the flesh, that Israel would be saved. Remember what he says. He says, if it were possible, he himself would be cut off for them. Well, he had a desire to see his kinsmen according to the flesh saved. And we should be praying too that God would actually bring awakening to our nation and revival to the churches, and that this land, which at one time was the greatest mission sending source in the world, is now in need of missions, and to pray that God would raise up churches that would preach the gospel. This should be our heartbeat. I will tell you that as we decline more and more and more, it becomes increasingly obvious that our only hope is a move of God. The great British awakening, we call it the First Great Awakening, happened both in the colonies and in the UK, in Great Britain. You read Arnold Dallimore's work on George Whitefield. England at that time in the 1720s and early 30s was on a point of virtual collapse. The moral degradation, the abuse of children, putting children to work, the gin craze. By the way, the gin craze outdid anything regarding meth. It was a nation that was on the brink of collapse. And do you know what saved it? The great evangelical awakening of Whitfield and Wesley. Not only did God spare the nation because of the awakening, but God used men like Whitfield and Wesley to actually bring about not only eternal changes through the force of the gospel, but also cultural changes. Do you realize that it was John Wesley and his Methodist societies? Now, Wesley's theology was not the greatest, but I will tell you, his Methodist societies, where he taught a Christian work ethic, created a middle class in England that actually exists to this day. What do we need more than anything else? We need God to bring awakening to this nation of ours. John Knox's most famous prayer and most common prayer was this. You know John Knox, and he would say this: God, give me Scotland or I'll die. Do we ever pray like that? God, save this nation. Save our country. Well, I'm focused on heavenly things. If you're focused on heavenly things, then you should love your neighbor as yourself and labor for the good of the country in which God has placed you. And so I think that's a pretty good sketch of what it looks like to love your country. Let me just close with this: warnings and counsels. So for those of you with pietistic leanings, this is going to make you happy. Can I love my country too much? The answer is yes. Yes. Let me give you three ways that you can tell whether you love your country too much. Okay? This is where you got to pay attention. All right? First, if I feel I have more in common with someone because we're Americans rather than because we are Christians, I love my country too much. If you're a Christian, you have more in common with a Christian from the Sudan than you do with a pagan American down the street. If you're a Christian, you should find a deeper common bond with somebody who professes Christ in Zambia than the pagan who works with you next in the cubicle at your office. Okay. In other words, just simply shared common cultural values, that's all fine and good, but if I find that I gravitate towards people just because we share America in common, and I don't find that I actually gravitate towards believers in Christ, no matter where they're from, then I love my country too much. John Piper says this. He says, never feel more attached to your fatherland or your tribe or your family or your ethnicity than you do to the people of Christ. Everyone who is in Christ is more closely and permanently united to others in Christ, no matter the other associations, than we are to our nearest fellow citizen or party member or brother or sister or spouse. Oh, how many horrible indignities, injustices, contradictions of Christianity have been perpetrated because believers have failed to realize this. We are more bound together with other believers, no matter their ethnicity or their political alignments or their nationality, than we are to anybody in our own fatherland. Second, if my concerns for my own country eclipse concerns for the nations in terms of missions and the persecuted church, I love my country too much. There is something that is somewhat humorous when you travel around a little bit, and that is you realize that people in the world outside of the United States are much more aware of what's going on in the world than people in the United States. Okay? It's absolutely true. Okay? People, and by the way, all you need to do is sit in a little cafe in Zambia and watch the news, and you realize they're interested in what's going on all over the world. You know what we're interested in? What happens here. That's all we're interested in. In fact, Americans are the dumbest in terms of geography. Okay? It's absolutely true. Okay? How many of you could, I know some of you could, but how many of you could name 10 African nations, right? I mean, we don't, you know what our problem is? We don't care. So if we're more concerned about, let me put it in concrete terms. Should I be concerned with what's going on in terms of the riots and the protests and the violence and all of that? And the answer is absolutely yes. But if that concern absolutely eclipses any concern I have for the suffering of Christians in Nigeria, I love my country too much. Do you know what's happening in Nigeria? Kidnappings, rapes, wiping out entire Christian villages? And who in America even knows? Who in America even cares? If you're more concerned about the stock market than you are the state of believers in North Korea, you love your country too much. Third, this one is meant to sting. Just giving you a heads up. If political issues consume me and squeeze out the means of grace and my walk with God, don't presume that your patriotism or your nationalism is an okay substitute for real spirituality. Okay. You do know that there are Christians who are so consumed in the political world, and the air that they breathe is just politics, 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 and they're consumed with it, and they have no time for the means of grace, no time for Bible reading, no time for church, no time for prayer, and yet they think that because they're political animals and they're patriotic, that that's a okay substitute for spirituality, and it's not. I would rather have a person who could tell you all about the book of Jeremiah than I would a person who could tell you everything that's happening right now on the political stage. Yes, you should be informed, absolutely. By the way, social media feeds this. It feeds it. How much could we say about that? Okay, so next, what about Christians who disagree with each other politically? Okay. Now, let me just say that when I say politically, I'm not talking about the great moral issues that we were talking about earlier, okay? I don't think, brothers and sisters, that there is any room for a Christian to actively support abortion or pro-abortion candidates. Okay? All right? How can you, in good conscience? Seriously. I don't think that there's room to support a platform that is promoting LGBTQ agendas if you're a Christian, okay? But that does not mean that there are not legitimate political differences among Christians. Have you ever stopped to think about this? Jesus is going to choose 12 disciples, okay? Just 12. One is Simon. And what was he called? The Zealot. Okay. He chose another one who was Levi, the tax collector. Now, I want you just to ponder for a moment some of the discussions that the disciples must have had on their many miles of walking together, because Simon the Zealot, actually, the Zealot meant he was a Jewish nationalist who despised Rome and despised the rule of Rome and despised everything about Rome. He was the most anti-government guy you could get. You talk about a right winger, Simon the Zealot is it. What about old poor Levi? Tax collector, guess who he worked for? The Roman IRS. Do you not think that there were some pretty interesting discussions between the zealot and the tax collector? Like this. Are you out of your Jewish mind working for Rome? Collecting taxes from your Jewish brothers and sisters? You, what's the word? You traitor. I wonder if Jesus actually did it on purpose. As Christians, we should actually have a charity and a latitude with those who disagree with us politically. I know that's hard, but I will tell you, you have to be biblically savvy enough to understand that there is a difference between the issues that emerge from a biblical worldview and issues that are just simply the political hot potatoes of the day. They're not always the same. Last, and we're done. So what if I get really, really anxious or really, really angry over the state of my country? Is that relevant for anybody? Anybody anxious about the way things are going right now? Right? I mean, there's a sense where I was watching the news the other night, and Ariel was making dinner, and I turned the channel to the Waltons. And she said, thanks for changing the channel. I said, well, the Waltons won't get me riled up. The news will. Okay. You get angry? You think about what people are doing to our nation? You get angry? You get anxious? So Dabney, again, writing in 1860, wants you to think about the anxiety that the country was in, as he wrote. He says, when every mind is filled by eager secular concerns, when angry passions rage in every heart, dividing brother against brother in Zion, when unscrupulous haste precipitates multitudes into words and acts of injustice and wrong, agitating and defiling their own consciences and provoking the hot tumults of resentment on either side, he then asks, what room is there for the quiet and sacred voice of the Holy Spirit? It has been remarked by wise historians that a time of political convulsions is a time of giant growth for all forms of vice. And just to that degree, it is a time of barrenness for the Christian graces. And so if I'm anxious, what do? I remember that my God reigns. Absolutely in control. He's the king. There's not a single thing that's happened that's outside of his control. This is where the sovereignty of God means the most, is when life does not make sense. My God reigns and he rules. And none of this chaos has taken him by surprise. He's unfolding the counsel of his own will according to his eternal purpose. And so I don't need to be afraid. What do? If I'm anxious or I'm angry? I pray, right? Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, make your request known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. You pray. What do? Trust the sovereignty of God. You pray. And then you, at times, you just have to say, this life is short and it's temporary. Yes, tumult, yes, convulsions, yes, violence, yes, everything's falling apart and it breaks my heart. But one of these days, I will look back and this will just simply be a blip on the screen. This world is passing away. It's passing away. So, as Christians, we should be thankful for our country. We should mourn for our nation and our national sins. And we should pray and we should work for its peace. But we do this not because America is our ultimate hope. We do this because Jesus is Lord over every area of life, including our earthly citizenship. Amen. Well, let's pray. Father, we thank you for guidance and help from your word. And Lord, we have concerns and our hearts ache over the current state of our nation. But Father, we take great comfort in knowing that you reign. Father, we pray that you would help us, Father, to avoid, on the one hand, completely isolating ourselves from this world in which we live. And on the other hand, Father, help us from being so totally consumed with it that we lose sight of the things that are eternal. And so, Father, we pray that you would help us to live out of deep conviction and a biblical worldview. And Father, above all else, help us to be loyal to Jesus Christ. Father, at the end of the day, he is alone our blessed hope. We give him thanks and praise in Christ's name. Amen.
We hope that you were edified by this message. For additional sermons, as well as information on giving to the ministry of Grace Community Church, please visit us online at gracenevada.com. That's gracenevada.com.